Mariner Books and Harper Audio present Rockaway, Surfing Headlong into a New Life. Written and read by Diane Cardwell.
Prologue. Over the Falls. February 2013. Still I must on, for I am as a weed flung from the rock on ocean's foam to sail. Where'er the surge may sweep, the tempest's breath prevail. Lord Byron, Childe Harold's Pilgrimage. Is this how it ends? The thought burned through my head, surprising and unbidden. I was straddling a surfboard in a thrashing ocean, breathless and struggling to stay upright, my arms so tired and aching I could barely lift them. Looking up, I saw my friends waiting for me on the shore, but they and the palm trees lining the cliffs all appeared to be receding. I'd been trying to get back to the beach for what felt like an eternity, and every time I took a moment's rest, the heaving aquamarine waters tugged me farther away from the stretch of sand I needed to reach. I felt overwhelmed and small, as if in the clutches of a liquid bully tossing me this way and that, while wind whipped my dark, wet curls against my cheeks, salt spray stung my eyes, and surging water plugged my ears and gushed into my mouth and up my nose. The current was pulling me parallel to the coast, where bulkheads of razor-sharp coral and rocks could shred my flesh like a cat-o'-nine-tails. As my body started to fail, it dawned on me for the first time that I might not make it back. Just an hour before, I'd been relaxed and happy. I'd arrived at the beach near the northwest corner of Puerto Rico with a friend, a feisty green-eyed brunette I'd met back home as I'd haplessly tried to learn to surf over the past few years. She was not only my regular buddy in the waves, but also one of the first new friends I'd made in a decade, part of the social life I was building as I slowly emerged from the wreckage of a divorce. Rented boards in hand, we were excited to escape the February chill of New York City and the rubble-strewn mess of my neighborhood in Rockaway Beach, still in recovery from the battering of Superstorm Sandy. Standing under the canopy of fanning leaves in the dirt parking lot overlooking the beach, we ran into a few friends from Rockaway who had just finished their sessions. Sure, it was a little choppy, with the swirl of the current making spirals of white foam amid the translucent peaks. But the waves were weaker than they looked, one of them said, and not much to worry about. Watch out for the current, though, another friend told us. Make sure you don't let it take you out to the left. Just paddle at an angle the other way. Maybe I shouldn't do this, I'd thought, eyeing the waves as they reared up and twisted before violently crashing toward the shore. But I'd quickly silenced that voice. As long as I kept to the right, I'd be fine. I'd always been able to handle myself in the ocean at home on the East Coast, and I was aching for the balm of wild water on my skin. I just couldn't resist. Plus, I needed this break from the rest of my life, which felt in shambles. Over the past 5 years, I'd been lashed by loss after loss. My marriage, my father, my chances of bearing a child. I was, in every sense of the word, adrift. Surfing, despite my distinct lack of aptitude and struggles to find my balance in the ocean, consistently brought me joy and a sense of purpose. On a surfboard, I could feel powerful and free and in tune with the universe, if only for an instant. The rest of the time, I felt the opposite. And now there was a clear and present danger confronting me. After I stepped into the warm, inviting water sliding over the sand, I had focused so intently on charging through the walls of foam lining up in front of me that I hadn't noticed the current, stronger than I realized, taking me exactly where I didn't want to go, to the left. So despite my efforts to paddle back, I was now stuck outside, the term surfers use for the zone beyond where the waves are breaking, and far from where I could safely return to shore. My surf buddy was nowhere to be seen in the water, having probably and wisely ditched the effort sooner. It doesn't matter how many people you're surfing with, I thought. In the end, you're alone, just you and the ocean. What if I can't get in by myself, I wondered as I contemplated my predicament. I closed my eyes and saw an unlikely fever dream pastiche of lost at sea images. Sunburned survivors found in life rafts having subsisted on raw fish, birds, and their own urine. Old-style paintings of half-nude women shipwrecked and flung upon the sand. Headlines about teenagers who'd fallen prey to riptides seemingly every year in the Rockaways. The Andrea Gale buffeted by mammoth seas before sinking. Gilligan and the skipper losing control of the SS Minnow on what was supposed to be a 3-hour tour. I peered at the beach. I was even farther from my friends, who now looked like stick figures on the sand. Can they tell I'm in trouble? Can they call in a rescue? Can I hold on long enough, or will I get swept out to sea? Are there sharks out there? Resting, I tried to tamp down the rising sense of dread, but I couldn't keep other kinds of doubts from creeping in. Maybe I was just not meant for this. If I'd so wrongly assumed I was ready for this ocean, I might very well have been wrongly convinced that I could actually have a role with the swell surfer's life, that I could, in middle age, pivot from my get-ahead, career-focused existence to something that seemed more meaningful. Maybe it was too late for that, just like it was too late to save my marriage, too late to get pregnant, too late to find another great love. I was clinging to a rented surfboard and maybe to a rented life, one I could dip into from time to time, but couldn't really make my own. I looked around and took in the spectacular beauty of the place, seeing how close to and yet still so far from safety I was. What a ridiculous place to die. Suddenly, something in me snapped. So what? So what if I didn't have the answers, or a partner, or the picture-perfect life I thought I was building? I'd bought, not rented, this new life, and now I had to live it. You got yourself into this mess, and it's up to you and you alone to get out of it. I sat up and took a deep breath as I arched my back and stretched out my chest, squeezing my shoulder blades together and shutting my eyes against the brilliance of the sky. Overcome, I yelled out, "No, not now!" Words that were immediately swallowed by the water's roar. I flopped back down on the board and began pulling my arms through the chop, hardly able to hold up my chest and head, but willing myself to ignore the soreness and near paralysis settling into my shoulders, arms, and back. "You can do this," I chanted, over and over like a mantra, cackling at how insane and uncool I must have looked, a million miles away from one of those sinewy surf babes I was trying to become. "Dig deeper." Eventually, I cast an eye toward the shore and saw the stack of logs that doubled as stairs between the beach and the parking lot and realized that I was almost where I needed to be. Looking out toward the horizon, I noticed waves cresting and threatening to break, waves that looked like they could swallow and pummel me. I needed to get beyond them, where I could maybe catch one or slip back in between them. One began rising up beside me, so I slowly spun the board around and headed toward it with what little strength I had left, thinking I could punch through the lip. But the ocean had a different idea. As I began sailing through to the other side, I felt a force like the hand of Poseidon grab the tail of my board, spin it around, and thrust it down the crumbling face of the wave. Water churned and rumbled around me as I gripped the edges of the board and lifted my chest, hoping that would keep me afloat and off the ocean floor. As I hurtled along, the curtain of water swaddling my head parted, and I could see that I was speeding toward the shore, where my friends were jumping up and down, yelling and gesturing for me to stand up and actually surf the wave. But I had noodles for arms and nothing left to launch my cramping body onto my feet. I was missing a shot at the very thing I traveled for, a ride on a wave, my skin bathed in sunlight and droplets of warm water. It was a disappointment, but I barely had the energy to care. As I neared the beach, I rolled off the board in exhaustion and relief, dragged it out of the water and dropped it in the sand, then hunched over to rest my elbows on my knees. I stayed there, panting, and listened to my heartbeat slow as the waves crashed and receded somewhere behind me and a sense of security returned. I'd survived the ordeal with no real harm, at least not to my body. I would live to surf another day, and that, in this moment, was all that mattered. Part 1. At sea. I suddenly realized that I was no member of the crew, simply a blind passenger. Frederick Koner, Gidget, the little girl with big ideas. 1. First Light, June 2010. It was summer and I was desperate for a way out of the city. Under normal circumstances, I'd have had summer plans already, a weekend share somewhere with my husband, visits with friends upstate, or a long trip vineyard hopping in France or Northern California, or hiking and kayaking in Canada or Maine. But I was nearly 3 years divorced, and this summer was mine, all mine and looking really empty. As I sat at my desk in the third-floor newsroom of the New York Times in Midtown Manhattan, bundled in a scratchy wool cardigan against the air-conditioned chill, I peered through the glass skin of the building at the people striding along the sidewalks below and at the buses winding up through the maze of ramps stacked above the Port Authority transit terminal across the avenue. It seemed that everyone was on the move. I'd been a reporter at the Times for nearly a decade and had a new beat covering the city's hospitality industry for the Metro Desk. I'd convinced my editor that since so many of the restaurateurs, hoteliers, business executives, celebrities, and others from that scene would be heading out of town for this season, especially to the East End of Long Island, I should follow the annual exodus for my next article. But I hadn't yet found a specific story idea good enough to justify the expense of a trip, so I was on the phone fishing for leads with Jim, a longtime colleague who spent summers in Montauk, the remote and quirky fishing village at the island's prow. "Ooh," he said, "I know what you should write about. It's such a good story, but I almost don't want to tell you. I just kind of don't want to draw attention to it." "Oh, come on," I said into my headset. "You've got to at least tell me what it is. If you don't want me to write about it, I won't. But if it's such a good story, somebody else, like the Wall Street Journal, is going to figure it out and do it first." Yeah, okay, you're right," he said. "Plus, I know it's kind of crazy to think I can keep anything about Montauk under wraps." I heard a deep inhale, and then his voice dropped low, as if to arrange a parking garage rendezvous to spill state secrets. "The Montaukett's for sale. They're asking, like, $17 million.
"What's the Montaukett, and is that a lot of money for it?"
"Oh my God, the Montaukett," Jim said, his voice back to normal volume. "It's a big deal if it sells." The Montaukett, it turned out, was a scruffy bar and motel perched high on a bluff overlooking Fort Pond Bay on Montauk's northern coast that had been considered for generations to be the best place in the area to watch the sunset. Though the End, as the town is known, is technically an unincorporated hamlet that's part of Greater East Hampton, it had long eschewed that gloss and instead clung fiercely to its maritime history, blue-collar ethos, and hippie surfer vibe. But as wave after wave of development replaced mildewed budget lodgings with whitewashed boutique hotels catering to the fashionable set, the Montaukett had become the last bastion of the townies, Jim told me, and a kind of stand-in for the place's soul. It was, as Jim said, a good story, and since the 4th of July was approaching, a good time to tell it, as editors always wanted a fun, summery piece to run near the holiday weekend. Which was why, on a Saturday afternoon a week or so later, I sat at the bar of the Montaukett, breathing the salt air of the bay and scribbling in a reporter's notebook. I took in the framed portraits of fish and seascapes on the walls, drinks listed on chalkboards, and heavy wood beams crossing the ceiling. There was a cigarette machine near the entrance, a jukebox in a corner, and a manual cash register behind the bar that was actually in use, not just for show. The place was practically empty, but a young man and woman were out on the back patio, hardly able to keep their hands or mouths off one another. The bartender, an efficient, no-frills woman in a black tank top, leaned her head out through an open window toward them. "I'd tell you to get a room, but we don't have any," she yelled. "I'm sick of looking at you licking each other like ice cream cones." She came back in and passed by me on her way to another task, rolling her eyes and shaking her head. The whole thing was feature story gold. A few hours later, the sunset crowd descended. I stepped outside and watched them quickly fill the picnic table benches and patio chairs under the soft glow of string lights and the descending sun, masked by cottony clouds hovering over the calm ripples of the bay. The jukebox blared Springsteen's No Surrender, and a man in cargo shorts and a clam power t-shirt held aloft his Amstel light, bellowing along, "No retreat, baby!" I slipped back inside the bar and, scanning the tightly packed room, spotted two men who appeared to be in their 60s. I introduced myself in the hope that they could tell me some of the history. "How long have you been coming here?" I asked. "Since the 70s, said one of them, a retired contractor with thinning dark hair and a button-down shirt. "It was an old man's bar and I was a younger man then. Now I'm the old guy." The place, they told me, was a popular spot for fishing vacations among Jones Beach lifeguards once the season ended, and a favorite of Billy Joel's. "It used to be like time stopped here," said the other man, a white-haired guy in a coral polo shirt and khakis, whose family had begun spending summers in Montauk in the 1920s.
Everything was held in place, like a picture of Roosevelt. Now, he said, because of the trendy hordes that routinely swamped the town, we're just trying to hold back the floods. I looked around at the crowd as the occasional raucous laugh shot through the din of weekend night voices ricocheting off the ceiling. Outside,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.